Good evening, all of you who have joined this web series. On behalf of IIM Mumbai chapter, it is my sort of a pleasure duty to invite all of you for this lecture series. Due to COVID-19 pandemic, our lecture evening series has reached to a screeching halt, and because of that, we could not do anything after the month of February. So to make this thing up, we are arranging three lecture series through webinar, a new mode, to work out how the work is being, how the new things are opening up. So this is a sort of a new experiment from us. So in that three lecture series, the first lecture will be given by Dr. Poulomi Chakravarty. She is working on the fusion reactor material-based material, and she has done a lot of work on that. And before starting this lecture, Dr. Vivekanand Kane, who is the chairman of our IIM Mumbai chapter, will give you a brief history about the IIM. Over to Dr. Kane.
Welcome to this event organized by the Indian Institute of Metals, Mumbai chapter. I am Vivekanand Kane, chairman of the Mumbai chapter of the Indian Institute of Metals. I'm going to give you a glimpse of the Indian Institute of Metals and specifically the typical activities that Mumbai chapter organizes for its members. The institute, the idea for the institute was conceived in 1945, and a small group of metallurgical professionals based at Bombay, that time they had formed the Bombay Metallurgical Society, played a key role. So from 1945, several people including Bombay Metallurgical Society, started working on this idea of formation of a national level of institute. The institute was inaugurated in 1947 with 42 founder members and 11 council members. The institute was inaugurated on 29th of December 1947 by Shri Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, Minister for Industry and Supply at that time. Shri Jahangir Gandhi was the first president, and Dr. Dara P. Antia was the first honorary secretary of the institute, and the office space at Calcutta was provided by the House of Tatas. Although the institute was inaugurated in 1947, the seed for that was through this council, which was formed earlier, and the first organizational meeting was held on 24th of February 1946. Therefore, the Indian Institute of Metals in February 2021 will be starting its 75th year celebrations, because the first meeting of the council was held in February 1946. At that time, several international institutes, including the Institute for Metals, UK, and the Institute of Iron and Steel, UK, they advised that India should not go for separate institutes for each subtopic in the field of metallurgy and materials. Therefore, right from that stage, the scope of the institute included all the topics such as mineral beneficiation, extraction of materials, fabrication of materials, heat treatment, finishing, as well as practical and theoretical aspects of metallurgy of all ferrous and non-ferrous metals and alloys, including ceramics and other disciplines and technologies which come in the broad field of metallurgy and materials. Almost all the activities of the institute are carried out through the honorary services of its office bearers and council members, and through the chapter chairmen, secretaries, and treasurer of, currently we have 57 chapters in the country. The vision of the institute includes increased global visibility for the IIM, cooperating with the related government departments on policy formulations, focused services to be provided to industry with higher degree of industry-specific interaction, as well as career development and encouraging young metallurgists. The annual general body of the Indian Institute of Metals is typically held at the end of July of every year. And so last month itself, we had Dr. Amol Gokhale taking over as the president of the institute. As I told you, institute has three divisions through which it operates. These divisions are Ferrous Division, Metal Sciences Division, and Non-Ferrous Division. These divisions are chaired by, so the Ferrous Division is chaired by Shri T.V. Narendran, who is also the Vice President of the Institute. Metal Sciences Division, the chairman is Dr. Samir Kamath, he is the Vice President of the Institute. And Mr. Satish Pai is the chairman of the Non-Ferrous Division and Vice President of the Institute. The Indian Institute of Metals has more than 10,000 members. A very big work being done by the Institute is to hold the Associate Membership Examination, AMIIM degree, which it provides, which had been earlier recognized by the Government of India as equivalent to BTech in metallurgy. There has been some changes recently where all these associate membership examinations are not being recognized, and the institute is working with the government to restore the status. The publications of the institutes form a major activity. Transactions of the Indian Institute of Metals is an international journal, and the impact factor of this journal in the last 1 year itself has jumped to a very high number under the editorship of Professor Murthy. IIM Metal News is a bi-monthly publication provided to all the members, and IIM and TIFEC, Government of India body, had published a series of strategy cum source books on non-ferrous metals and alloys. The National Metallurgist Day is the annual event which is held along with the annual technical meeting of the institute. NMD is the day when the institute, along with the Ministry of Steel, Government of India, recognize the excellent work done by the metallurgical fraternity members in the country. The institute gives away, or through the institute, the Ministry of Steel gives away these following awards: Lifetime Achievement Award, National Metallurgist Award, Metallurgist of the Year Awards, and Young Metallurgist of the Year Awards. At the same time, the winner of the Professor Brahm Prakash Memorial Quiz are also given the awards. This is a national level quiz for students, which is held every year. Students of 11th and 12th standard participate in this quiz. All the 57 chapters, they hold the chapter level memorial quiz, and the winner from each chapter, that team is sent for the national level quiz. This is a very popular program of the institute. The institute on NMD Day also gives various awards. These are Indian Institute of Metals awards. There are IIM honors, including honorary membership and fellowship, National Sustainability Awards, and Best Chapter Awards, apart from several individual awards, some of which are listed here. Coming to the Mumbai chapter specifically, Mumbai chapter is a vibrant chapter. It's a large chapter, classified as a large chapter, and it has three pillars. Members basically come from the Department of Atomic Energy, Bhabha Atomic Research Center, IIT Mumbai, and from several industries which are in and around the Mumbai region. The chairmanship, currently I am the chairman and Professor Indradev Samajdar is the vice chairman. The secretaries also are from these respective organizations at this time, Dr. Raghavendra Tiwari from BRC and Professor Prasad from IIT Bombay, and our treasurer is Dr. D.K. Singh. But in Mumbai chapter, we rotate the chairmanship, and after the term of Bhabha Atomic Research Center, the term will be for IIT Bombay. So Professor Samajdar would be proposed as the next chair for the coming year. And after that will be the turn of industry. So between these three organizations, the executive committee members as well as the chairmanship keeps rotating, although the EC executive committee is constituted by drawing members from all these three pillars. A brief look at the events which were organized in the last 1 year itself. We start the year with the C.V. Sundaram Memorial Lecture just before the annual general body meeting, and look at the various evening lectures which were conducted during the year. Some of these lectures with different organizations including ASM, NACE, IIT Bombay, etc. And some were organized by the Mumbai chapter itself. But you look at the topics starting from the titanium alloys to aircraft turbine engines to uranium and its scope in the country and in the world, various aspects of it, radiation effects in materials to corrosion resistance to coatings and thin film solar cell materials. This covers a wide spectrum of topics which were offered to the members of the IIM Mumbai chapter. Mumbai chapter also hosted the National Council meeting at Mumbai on 2nd of October. Industrial visit is a key part of our activities. This year, during 1920, in the month of December, our members went to the Everest Canto Cylinder Company at Tarapur, and a national conference was organized on rare earths, science, technology, and applications of rare earths. The C.V. Sundaram Memorial this year in 2020 will be delivered by Dr. Madan Gopal Krishnan, Director of Materials Group. Apart from this C.V. Sundaram Memorial lecture, which the Mumbai chapter organizes, Mumbai chapter and Baroda chapter together also organize Y.M. Mehta Memorial Lecture. So 1 year it is organized by Mumbai chapter and the next year it is organized by the Baroda chapter. The coming year, that is in January 2021, is the turn for Mumbai chapter to organize the Y.M. Mehta Memorial Lecture. With a vibrant slate of activities which I just showed you, I am sure that if you work in the field of metallurgy and materials, you would want to be a part of these activities. So I urge you to become a member of the Institute, and to become the member, you simply have to go to the website which is mentioned here, iim-india.net, and fill up the forms there and you will become a member of the Institute. The Mumbai chapter itself has its own website where we post all the activities which we are going to hold in the coming year and any other announcement which we have for the members. The website for Mumbai chapter, iim-mumbai.com, kindly visit that and be a part of the activities which Mumbai chapter holds and the Indian Institute of Metal holds for its members. Thanks.
Hello everybody. I hope all of you are doing well in these tough times of coronavirus pandemic. I'm Palmi Chakrabarty from Material Science Division BARC. And at the outset, I would like to thank the Indian Institute of Metals Mumbai chapter for giving me an opportunity to speak before you in this webinar series. As you have already guessed, the topic of my presentation today involves the development of a very challenging and innovative technology, that is that of the nuclear fusion reactor. I'm a metallurgist by profession, and for the past 10 years since my joining BRC, I have been working mainly for the development of special materials for fusion reactor applications. However, in today's talk, I would like to give you a brief overview about certain basics of fusion. Then I will move on to the ITER mega project. I'm sure many of you are aware about that. Afterwards, I will talk a little about Indian involvement in ITER, specifically the Indian test blanket module. And then I will speak about the role of liquid metals in fusion reactor applications, and especially the liquid metal corrosion. And finally, I would like to give you a glimpse about what kind of work our group in BRC is carrying out for the development of special materials for Indian TBM. But I thought, why don't I begin the talk with a very common problem about which all of us are aware about, that is the energy crisis scenario. As you can see from this first graph, where the energy consumption rate has been plotted along with the years starting from 1965 to 2015, it is very clear that the energy consumption rate has been steadily increasing day by day. But till today, the maximum fraction of this energy used still comes from non-renewable energy resources like oil, coal, and natural gas. And all of us know what kind of adverse effect these sources can have on our atmosphere, mainly by producing obnoxious gases like carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide. So thus, today the world is actually facing an energy paradox. What is the paradox? Here, although we know that our energy demand, as per this graph, will keep on growing exponentially beyond the 21st century, but in order to save our environment, in order to save the mankind, we need to keep the carbon dioxide emissions below a certain permissible limit. In this case, it is around 550 ppm. So what do we do to save our environment? So for this purpose, we basically need to decouple the energy consumption from the CO2 emissions. And how can we do that? We can do that only by changing our preferred modes of energy used. So basically, we need to shift our focus from non-renewable energy sources to renewable and other sources. And one of the very prominent sources which the entire world is focusing upon nowadays is that of nuclear energy. Speaking about nuclear energy, we all know that there are mainly two types of nuclear reactions, that is fission and fusion. And fusion basically means joining, that is joining of bonds. So fission basically means breaking of bonds. But why does this fission and fusion take place? What is the origin of this nuclear reaction? For this purpose, I would like to show you a very basic graph known as the binding energy curve, which is a very important tool for the nuclear scientists and technologists. Here, basically, we plot the binding energy per nucleon. That by nucleon, I mean neutron or proton, along with the mass number of various elements, as we know in our periodic table. So you can see very clearly the peak of the binding energy curve generally belongs to those elements lying in the medium atomic mass range, that is around 50 to 60. And therefore, it is the isotopes of nickel and that of iron which are considered most stable, which lies at the peak of the binding energy curve. However, as we move from either side, either to the left or the right, the binding energy per nucleon decreases, meaning the atoms become more and more unstable. So every unstable element has a natural tendency to go towards a stable state. And how will they go towards the stable state? There are two ways. The elements which have high atomic masses, like uranium, they will attain stability by splitting into two low mass elements. How do they do that? They do that by the first nuclear reaction, that is fission. So uranium breaks into two different low mass elements like barium and krypton, and therefore they attain the medium atomic mass range. On the other hand, if we go towards the lower extremity, where we have low mass elements like hydrogen, helium, carbon, they can attain stability by joining together so that they again move towards the medium range. And this process in which they join is known as fusion. So therefore, here you can see two hydrogen isotopes, deuterium and tritium, can join together to form helium and thereby move slowly towards the right of the binding energy curve. Nuclear fusion, it is universally known that it is the powerhouse of our entire powerhouse of our universe. It powers the sun, it powers the stars, and it's a clean source of energy. Why clean? I will come to that later. But since I have talked about deuterium and tritium, this is a typical fusion reaction where you can see deuterium atoms and tritium atoms are joining to form a helium atom and emitting a neutron. And along with that, it is producing a large amount of energy, that is around 17.6 MeV. The maximum part of this energy is taken away by the neutron itself. So you can imagine how much damaging capability this neutron can have over the structural materials. But this neutron has one more advantage also. The neutron can be used to interact with a lithium-based compound, to produce tritium, which is again the fuel for this reaction. And thus, it can serve as a closed cycle. But when I'm talking of hydrogen isotopes, why are we only specifically talking about deuterium and tritium? We can have other reactions also. We can have DT, we can have DD, we can have even deuterium helium. But it has been researched over the years that it is the fusion of deuterium and tritium which is easily attainable at the lowest plasma temperature. If you see from this graph, this blue line corresponds to the DT reaction, and the reaction rate for DT is highest at the comparatively lower temperature as compared to DD and other reactions. So thus, most of the fusion reactions and most of the fusion research on Earth is focused on deuterium and tritium. But then, when we already have a matured and a working technology like nuclear fission, which has been used in most of the nuclear reactors working around the world, why are we focusing on fusion as a viable energy source? There are very certain advantages in this regard. The first one being that no greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide is produced from fusion. You have already seen the byproduct is only a very harmless element, which is helium. Fusion is inherently safe. Even if there is a loss of power in a fusion power plant, the only effect that can happen is that the plasma will quench down. So there is no problem of very severe accidents like loss of coolant accidents. On the other hand, the energy produced is also higher in fusion as compared to fission. It is 4 times higher. And also there is no problem of long-lived radioactive waste, particularly as a byproduct of fusion reaction. So therefore, there are much lesser problems of disposal. And finally, talking about the fuel supplies, for fusion are practically unlimited. If you consider a day's requirement, we only need 0.4 kg of tritium and 0.27 kg of deuterium to meet the fusion reactor's requirements in a day. So that is, these elements are abundantly available, particularly deuterium is very abundantly available in seawater, and tritium can be bred from lithium, as I have discussed before. So surprisingly, you must know that a lithium ion battery from one laptop is actually capable of serving a person through fusion energy in its entire lifetime. So therefore, we don't have to worry about the abundance of fusion fuels. So regarding tritium breeding, I have already shown you how lithium can be used to breed tritium. So therefore, a typical core of a fusion reactor will basically have a fusion plasma in its center where the actual fusion reaction is taking place between deuterium and tritium, and neutrons are being produced. And these neutrons can be used to interact with the lithium-based compound, which is placed as a blanket around the core, and the blanket produces tritium once again, which is fed back to the core. However, you must also know that there are basically two isotopes of lithium, lithium-6 and lithium-7. But here, for this particular breeding, we are only using lithium-6. The reason being that the tritium production cross-section of lithium isotopes is highest at the range of energy where fusion neutrons are emitted, that is 14 MeV. You can see a peak coming here. So therefore, it is lithium-6 isotope which is used for this particular purpose. So now, this brings us to the major interest of my presentation, that is the ITER project, The ITER project is an international effort which has come up for bringing the experimental plasma physics into a reality and converting it to a workable fusion reactor. The ITER is coming up at a place called Cadarache in France. And if you can see, this site is very close to the already existing site of the European Atomic Energy Commission, that is CEA. And also, it is close to a very beautiful and tourist town of Nice in France. The seven countries which are building the ITER, which have joined hands to build ITER, are USA, European Union, Russia, China, Japan, Korea, and of course, India. India has joined the ITER project in 2005, and since then, it has been contributing massively towards the progress of this development. So what are these countries doing actually? Basically, they have been entrusted with the task of building and supplying all the important components which will be assembled together to make ITER. And in that, India has also been given responsibility to supply very, very important components. The first one being the cryostat, which is presently being built at Larsen & Toubro in India. I think the development work is almost near the completion stage. India is also responsible for supplying cooling water system, heating systems, and various other components. So just to give you an idea about the cryostat, which our country is making for ITER, the ITER cryostat is actually of the size of the Jefferson Memorial Building in Washington, D.C. So therefore, it is almost 28 meters tall. And the cryostat itself will house the superconducting magnetic coils, which will be used for confining the plasma. Since ITER is a tokamak, it uses the magnetic confinement concept for stabilizing the plasma. So there will be superconducting coils. And this is an image, a schematic image of one superconducting coil. And this coil itself has the weight of similar to the massive Boeing 747 aircraft. So you can imagine the amount of technology needed to assemble such components into the ITER machine. And finally, the magnetic field itself, which is used for confining the plasma in ITER, is actually almost 10 to the power 4 times of our own Earth's magnetic field. So such a high magnetic field can have tremendous effects on all the structures as the functional materials for ITER, and this makes the building of this machine even more challenging. This is a photograph of the ITER site, which has been taken in August 2013, where only four buildings had started to come up. Next, this is in April 2018, where you can see the building progress is going on continuously, and now the ITER headquarters has been completed. The tokamak complex is also coming up. This is in August 2018, where the main tokamak complex is almost complete. And finally, here we have the inner view of the tokamak complex in April 2019, where it is visible that a number of ports are there in the inner walls of the tokamak complex. What are these ports for? These ports house a very important component, which is known as the test blanket module, or the TBM. Here you can see, this is basically a cross section of the ITER tokamak, the donut shaped tokamak. This is the fusion plasma, and this module, a box shaped test blanket module, which directly faces the plasma. And if I look more closely, a port in the ITER, these kind of ports basically has the capacity to house two such test blanket modules. So one port will have two such test blanket modules. What is a test blanket module? What is the necessity of a test blanket module? The test blanket module basically serves three important functions. The first one being achievement of tritium breeding and tritium self-sufficiency. So the test blanket module ensures that there is a lithium-based compound, one or two lithium-based compound, which can give us sufficient tritium to breed, sufficient tritium to feed into the nuclear reaction. Second, the test blanket module also has a very suitable coolant, mostly liquid metals. These coolants are used to extract the high-grade heat produced in fusion and bring it out so that we can use it in the form of electricity. And finally, the TBM also serves the purpose of shielding the neutrons or gamma rays which may come out of the fusion reactor. So here you can see, this is the plasma from where neutrons is coming out. This is the first wall of the TBM which directly faces the plasma, and then we have the tritium breeding zone where we can have liquid tritium breeders or solid breeders, tritium breeders. Then we have the coolant. The coolant can also act as a tritium breeder. And then we have the shield, the vacuum vessel, and the magnets. So, along with supplying so many important components to ITER, all the ITER partners are also building their own test blanket modules. Each test blanket module has its unique structural material, has its unique design, unique coolant, unique diagnostics. And the idea is that the best possible concept, the best possible test blanket module concept from these countries will be chosen after testing at ITER for the future fusion reactor, which can be a commercial one, and that is generally known as DEMO. So just like other countries, India has also developed its own unique test blanket module concept, which is known as the LLCB-TBM, or the lead lithium cooled ceramic breeder concept. What is the lead lithium cooled ceramic breeder? This is a schematic, a very simple schematic, where you can see this is the first wall, which are made up of special structural materials. And inside, we have channels which allow the flow of lead lithium. These white arrows are actually showing the flow of lead lithium eutectic within the walls, and they face the neutrons which come directly through the first wall and therefore help in breeding tritium from the lithium in the lead lithium eutectic. However, I would also like to point out that these particular channels also contain a solid, these channels also contain a solid breeder packed in between them. These solid breeders are generally of ceramic type, and particularly the one which is lithium titanate. So both the solid breeder as well as the liquid breeder serves for fulfilling the total tritium requirement for fusion reactor. This is the Indian TBM concept. So India actually has been allocated half a port. As I told, each port can house two TBM. So India has been allocated half a port for housing this LLCB TBM. The size of the TBM is 1.5 meter by 1 by 1 meter. So it's basically, if you imagine, it's like a big refrigerator, that's all. But that is a very important component, and that is very much required, because this is the first time that all the fusion technologists, all the fusion physicists are getting a chance to test their concept in an actual fusion reactor environment. So that's why TBM is important. However, the demonstration, the practical demonstration of TBM is not so easy. There are a lot of challenges associated with that. And one of the major challenges is that of the material. What kind of material should be used in such a harsh environment? By harsh, first of all, I mean the presence of very high intensity neutron radiation, 14 MeV. The energy of neutrons which we encounter today in the present day fast fission reactors is around 1 to 2 MeV. And here I'm talking about 14 MeV. So this has got huge damaging capability for the structural. Then the high temperature, which imposes a lot of thermal loads on the structure, the high magnetic field, which is used for confining the plasma, and lastly, the highly corrosive nature of the lead-lithium coolant, where my topic begins about liquid metal corrosion. It is known that both lead and lithium are individually very, very corrosive in nature, but I should tell you, lead-lithium eutectic in combination is even more corrosive. So this is another bigger challenge in this context. So what do we do? What kind of material? Presently, we have a type of steel which is available in market, which closely meets the requirement, and it is known as ferritic martensitic steel, for example, P91. This has got an open structure because of body-centered cubic structure with carbides at their grain boundary, and this imparts a higher resistance to irradiation, though therefore it causes lower swelling. But there is a disadvantage also. The disadvantage comes from the production of long-lived radioisotopes, mainly from alloying elements like molybdenum. So this kind of radioisotope allowed in fusion reactor, because this will make the disposal of the structure very, very difficult. So the solution has come in the form of a new type of steel, which is known as the reduced activation ferritic martensitic steel, or the RAFMS. The basic design concept is that we replace the alloying elements which produce long-lived radioisotopes with safer counterparts, like we can replace molybdenum with tungsten. So just like a variety of TBMs which has been developed around the world, all the countries are also developing their own RAFM steels. So you can see Europe has developed Eurofer, China has developed CLAM, Japan has developed JLF1, USA has its own steel, and India, of course, has developed Indian RAFMS. Indian RAFMS, or Indian Reduced Activation Ferritic Martensitic Steel, has a basic composition of 9 chrome, 1 tungsten. Chromium is around 9%, and tungsten is a replacement for molybdenum, close to 1.4%. The niobium in 9 chrome, 1 moly has been replaced by tantalum, and very strict control has been exercised over other trace elements so as to make it a very clean steel and avoid any kind of impurities which may give rise to other nuclear reactions which are not desired. The heat treatment of this steel has been stabilized, has been established to be normalizing and tempering, both followed by air cooling. The microstructure inside, where we have martensite lattes decorated by chromium carbides at the grain boundaries. These chromium carbides are again enriched with tungsten. The mechanical properties has been extensively studied at IGCAR Kalpakkam, and they are now fully established. They closely match with that of Eurofer. However, before this work, the corrosion behavior of this steel in lead lithium eutectic was not explored. So that is our major concern in the work that we have taken up. Just to give you an idea that why I am so much concerned about liquid metal corrosion, this is a photograph, this is a micrograph of SS316L, which was initially exposed to lead lithium eutectic in our lab. The light colored one is lead lithium eutectic, and you can see the extent of attack which has taken place through the grain boundary just in a period of 1000 hours. Almost a depth of 100 microns has been attacked. And I can tell you that such kind of attack not only damages the mechanical properties by making the material porous, it can even change the structure of the material from austenite to ferrite. So therefore, the analysis of liquid metal corrosion is very, very important. But why liquid metal corrosion is unique? Why we don't know much about that? That is mainly because the most common forms of corrosion, like rusting, which we encounter in day-to-day life, is basically aqueous in nature. By aqueous, I mean it is an electrochemical process. So there is a transfer of electrons, like oxidation reduction reactions, for example. However, liquid metal corrosion does not involve any electron transfer. It is a physical chemical process, and it mainly depends on the difference of chemical potential and the solubility of various elements in liquid metal. Therefore, the conventional techniques that we use for studying the aqueous corrosion, the electrochemical corrosion, cannot be used in this case, and we need to develop completely new technology for studying liquid metal corrosion, especially for long durations. Finally, coming to the objectives of our work that we have carried out in BRC, it begins with the development of material, since we need to qualify Indian RFMS with respect to its compatibility with lead lithium, and no reports were available till date on that in this regard. And this needs the development of technology, which involves various high temperature liquid metal corrosion test facilities, which were also not available till that time, to the best of my knowledge. And finally, we also needed to understand the liquid metal corrosion mechanism, particularly with respect to microstructure surface condition, so that we can develop new materials with improved corrosion resistance. So the first facility which we have developed in our lab is a fully automated liquid metal corrosion test facility, which allows us to study the elemental dissolution under static conditions. So there is basically a static liquid metal bath where we dip the corrosion coupons for certain time and take it out. It's not that simple. We had basically introduced a unique online sample replacement mechanism for this purpose, which actually allows us to dip the sample, to exchange the sample at controlled atmosphere at temperatures beyond 300. Why 300? Because the melting point of this lead lithium eutectic is very high. It is 235. So if I want to dip a sample in liquid form, I have to go at a temperature higher than 235. And once I go at a temperature higher than 235, the liquid becomes very, very prone to oxidation. So therefore, the entire operation has to be carried out in controlled atmosphere and remotely, because I cannot see also from outside. So this entire technology has been developed, And we have operated this facility for around 5 months continuously. We have used various liquid metals like lead, lead bismuth, lead lithium, and all the wetted parts of the facility has been made out of molybdenum since it is known to be resistant to liquid metal attack. With the help of static experiments, we have been able to establish that temperature greatly enhances liquid metal corrosion. We have also shown that out of P91 and RAFMS, where P91 is the surrogate material for RAFMS, it is RAFMS which is more resistant to corrosion. This is because of the presence of tungsten oxides on the RAFMS surface, along with other oxides like iron, chromium, which are also there in P91. But these tungsten oxides basically impart a higher corrosion resistance since they are more stable in lead lithium environment. Also, we have been able to show that it is iron dissolution, which is the rate controlling step for corrosion of RAFM steel in lead lithium, although the chromium has a higher solubility in lead lithium. But since chromium has a slower diffusivity in this steel, this coupling of slower diffusivity in steel and higher diffusivity in lead lithium actually leads to production of a chromium depleted zone on the surface. And with the help of various theoretical models, mainly involving diffusion models, we have been able to actually theoretically predict this chromium depletion zone for a certain duration. And to our great satisfaction, we have found that our modeling results have matched up to 90% accuracy with the experimental results. Talking about microstructure, this is actually the as-received microstructure of RAFMS, which is tempered martensite in nature. There are prior austenite grains. These are prior austenite grains where there are martensite lats, and all the boundaries are decorated by grain boundary carbides, which are shown in light color. But once I expose this to lead lithium, you can see what kind of attack that has taken place. Most of the grain boundaries have started to get attacked, the attack increasing with duration from 500 hours to 1000 hours. Another important thing is that the attack is non-uniform. It has not taken place uniformly over the entire surfaces. Some places are highly attacked, some places are less attacked. And by EDS analysis, we have seen that the less attacked surface are actually protected by the passive oxide layer, which I have talked about, the tungsten oxide, the iron oxide, till a period of 1000 hours. So therefore, there is a non-uniform dissolution of oxide scale, which gives rise to non-uniform attack in the initial duration. But this attack is preferentially grain boundary attack in nature. The mode of attack is grain boundary. Now, this grain boundary attack is basically due to ingress of lead and lithium. Ingress of lead has been easily mapped with the help of EDS. But to detect that how lithium is going inside our material is little bit tricky, because lithium cannot be detected with the help of EDS. So therefore, we have used SIMS, secondary ion mass spectroscopy. And here you can see we have been clearly able to show how lithium is present entirely along the attack grain boundary. And this gave us a first-hand evidence of such ingress of lithium, because lithium ingress has been reported very scarcely in literature. But why this grain boundary attack is taking place? For this purpose, we have analyzed the as-received material in detail in TBM. And in nanoscale, if you look at this image in TBM, this is a grain boundary carbide. And when we have taken an EDS scan of chromium along the carbide, we have found that actually a chromium depletion zone is existing of around 20 nanometers just adjacent to the carbide. This chromium depletion zone actually weakens the passive layer at this region, since the passive layer has a major component as chromium oxide. And therefore, once chromium is depleted in this adjacent layer, the passive layer weakens. And once the passive layer weakens, the regions along the grain boundaries become more prone to attack. And when they are prone to attack, not only grain boundary attack takes place, even the carbides which were present, they start dropping. If you look at this slide, here you can see the carbides which were initially present, the light color carbides, are not there in the attack material. So at least now we are in a position to completely describe why such grain boundary attack is taking place. The next facility which were developed is a very unique one. It is known as the rotating disc corrosion test facility, where we basically have a disc type of sample which is rotated in a pool of lead lithium. Once again, all wetted parts are made out of molybdenum. But the challenge lies in the fact that we cannot do such rotation by exposing the liquid to outer atmosphere. So for this purpose, we basically couple this disk with the overhead motor with the help of a magnetic coupling. This is the overhead motor. This is the main retort, and in between we have a magnetic coupling. So there is physical separation so that we prevent outside oxygen from entering into the facility. So here you can see this is an actual photograph of the disk which has been connected to the main shaft of the sample, and it has been operated extensively at temperatures up to 600 degrees Celsius. Through this facility, we have been able to conduct the longest duration experiment in Indian RFMS, that is up to 10,000 hours, that is more than a year. And you can see that although we have a linear corrosion rate after 2000 hours, but initially I have not put the values, but this initial rate before 2000 hours is comparatively lesser as compared to the late rate which has been found later. So this thin initial period characterized by lower corrosion rate is known as incubation period. What happens actually in that incubation period, I will show you later. But before that, this is a video of the CFD modeling which has been carried out in this facility, mainly in order to map the velocity profile. Because since this is a dynamic press facility, our main interest is to correlate the flow velocity with the corrosion that is taking place. And this video actually shows the motion path of corroded species once they come out of the disk and move into the liquid. And therefore, this gives us a very good idea about the corrosion kinetics which is taking place here. So here I will explain you what happens in incubation period. You can see within 2000 hours, the attack is once again grain boundary type in nature, as I have already discussed. And during such attack, the oxygen or the oxide layer is present mostly over the entire surface, leaving the grain boundaries where attack is taking place. But once I go to a higher duration in 10,000 hours, the attack mode completely changes to matrix dissolution. Why matrix dissolution? Because now the entire matrix is coming in picture as if it has been etched. The carbides have reappeared, and you can see that the oxygen content has completely reduced over the surface. So basically, the incubation period marks the end of dissolution of oxide layer. And after that, the entire surface gets equally exposed to lead lithium eutectic, which leads to a drastic increase in corrosion rate. So therefore, it is the change in mechanism which is reflected in the corrosion rate graph. In terms of velocity, we have also shown that as we move to higher and higher velocity, the depth of attack increases considerably. As you can see, it has increased from 16 to 24 micrometers when I move just from the center of the disk to the edge of the disk. And moreover, at higher velocity, we also find traces of erosion. We also find traces of grain dropping. And slowly, the material starts getting eaten away faster and faster. So with the help of this knowledge of the corrosion mechanism within and beyond incubation period, and with the help of the knowledge of how alloying elements are controlling, we are actually now in a position to design new materials which can have improved corrosion resistance. So that is basically grain boundary engineering. Now I come to the final part, which shows a very important facility, that is liquid metal loop. These liquid metal loops are basically used to simulate the actual reactor operating conditions. Fortunately, we are one of the six groups in the world which have working lead lithium loops to study lead lithium corrosion. The first loop that we have developed is a natural circulation loop where no external driving force is used for producing a circulation of lead lithium. It is basically the temperature difference between the hot leg and cold leg which creates a difference in density and thus drives the lead lithium. This loop has been operated at 6 centimeter per second velocity for 1500 hours initially, and these are the corroded samples which had come out of the loop. Next, we've moved on to a fourth circulation loop. Here, the circulation is established with the help of a pump. So for this particular loop, various important components like electromagnetic pump, the flow meter, heat exchanger, level indicators, all have been developed in-house in our workshop at BARC. And this loop has been operated for 5,000 hours continuously. So basically, this is a pump. This drives the flow. The metal moves in this circuit, and samples are placed somewhere in this test section. We take it out after a certain duration. This loop actually has generated the first ever corrosion rate data of Indian RFMS in flowing lead lithium. Later, we coupled magnetic field with the loop. You can see this kind of a dipole magnet was coupled into the test section. Here, the major challenge was that the magnet cannot be taken to a temperature beyond 80 degrees Celsius, since it will damage its magnetic capability. But the liquid is flowing at around more than 450 degrees Celsius, around 500, just close to the magnet. So how did we do that? Basically, we have introduced special insulations. We have done certain design modifications, and we have done very close monitoring of the temperature at various points in order to address this challenge. Very recently, we have been able to commission a first of its kind mechanical pump driven loop completely based out of P91 material. The material of construction is P91. This is a massive loop, and it allows us to conduct corrosion experiments for the first time at TBM relevant temperatures and pressure. So today we can operate this loop at velocities more than 2 meters per second and pressures up to 14 bar. We have already operated it up to 500 hours and still it is under operation. So just to give you an idea, I would like to show you a video of the electromagnetic pump driven loop in operation. You can see this is the electromagnetic pump which is rotating, the electromagnetic pump which houses a section of the loop, and the liquid flows through the discs of the pump. So this loop was operated for 5,000 hours continuously, where Indian RFMS samples were placed for the first time in flowing lead lithium. The loop experiments gave us an idea of how the magnetic field can also affect corrosion. Magnetic field not only enhances the corrosion rate, but it also changes the surface pattern. It changes the alloying element dissolution. It changes the mechanism. As you can see very clearly, these kind of surface patterns have been created inside magnetic field, whereas outside magnetic field, the patterns are completely different. The magnetic field has been also found to increase iron depletion from RFMS, and the mode of attack inside magnetic field is intralath attack, whereas it is interlath outside magnetic field. Interlath, by interlath I mean it is grain boundary attack in the incubation period. However, at the same time, inside magnetic field we are finding massive intralath attack. So the entire corrosion mechanism has been changed. So the reason for all these changes has been traced back and evaluated with the help of MHD coupled CFD. By MHD I mean magnetohydrodynamics. With the help of this process, we have been actually able to show that various electrical potentials are developed on the surface of the samples, which are placed in the magnetic field. The samples are conductive in nature. The lead lithium itself is conductive in nature. And we all know that a magnetic field will interact with any conductive material placed within its vicinity. So it is the interaction of these samples with the magnetic field which creates an electric potential, and the electric potential actually creates localized increase in corrosion. And such increase is the reason behind all these changes which has taken place inside magnetic field. So finally, after evaluating all these effects of various operating parameters, after knowing the mechanism of corrosion, we have also compared our own material with a reference material, that is Eurofer, which has been developed by European Union. And this comparison has been intentionally carried out at an international test condition. Indian RFMS was exposed along with Eurofer at the well-known Piccolo loop at Karlsruhe Institute of Germany for a continuous period of 12,000. Samples were taken out in between for almost 7 or 8 times. And to our great satisfaction, we have found that both Indian RFMS and Eurofer have behaved entirely in a similar manner, and the corrosion rates were comparable. So now we are actually in a position to say that Indian RFMS can be suitably used for Indian TBM applications and other fusion related uses. So therefore, with this, I would like to summarize. And for that, I would just like to say that the development of India fusion reactor technology in India is majorly divided into 3 components. The first one being its contributions towards ITER in the form of important components like cryostat. The second one being the development of Indian TBM, which itself is a boost to the entire fusion reactor program in India. And finally, the domestic fusion projects, which have been operating well before India's joining in ITER. We already have working tokamaks in Institute of Plasma Research, Gandhinagar. These are known as Aditya, SST1, SST2. Many of us, we know about that. And for fulfilling the requirements of these components, what we have done is that we have gone for material development, where we have fully established the corrosion behavior of Indian RFMS in a range of operating parameters and also compared with international. We have developed various new technologies like liquid metal loops, like the rotating disc corrosion test facility. And these technologies are now extensively being used for various other liquid metals and molten salts. The corrosion rate that we have established for Indian RFMS has been actually used during the design of Indian TBM for ITER. And all the components are also major achievements in this regard. And of course, in terms of science, we were the first timers in various new observations, particularly the corrosion mechanism within and beyond incubation period, the role of grain boundaries, the role of alloying elements, passive layer, and magnetic field. So before concluding, I will just like to let you know, or you may know already, that just very recently, a very important program has taken place at the ITER complex, that is on July 28, 2020. And this program marked the start of assembly of ITER tokamak. By start of assembly, I mean when assembly is being started, it is definitely sure that most of the components which were to be supplied by the partners have reached the ITER site. So as you can see, the partners, countries have all been present in this program, either in person or electronically. And as the saying goes, it is Vasudeva Kutumbakam. So that is, the entire world is now coming together through ITER for the benefit of mankind. And I just hope that ITER is a major success, and not very far away, very soon we will be able to see that ITER is working for the benefit of mankind. So thank you for your attention. And I would like to thank all my colleagues at Materials Group BARC for the support they have shown me over the years. And I truly believe that it is fusion for future. Thank you.